हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू टास्क आईएएस। टुडे वी विल कंटिन्यू आर्कियोलॉजिकल एंथ्रोपोलॉजी। वी हैव डिस्कस्ड पैलियोलिथिक, मेसोलिथिक, नियोलिथिक एंड टुडे वी विल डिस्कस चालकोलिथिक एंड कॉपर ब्रोंज। एंड वन इम्पॉर्टेंट इन्फॉर्मेशन इज दैट ऑल द पीडीएफ ऑफ इथिक्स एज वेल एज एंथ्रोपोलॉजी लेक्चर्स आर अवेलेबल इन टेलीग्राम चैनल एंड लिंक ऑफ दैट चैनल इज गिवन इन डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ वीडियो, सो यू कैन इन्जॉय दोज पीडीएफ्स एज वेल। सो चालकोलिथिक और कॉपर ब्रोंजेस, सो टिल नाउ मे बी इट इज पैलियोलिथिक और मीजोलिथिक और नियोलिथिक, ऑल आर स्टोनीज, बट नाउ ए मेटल एज स्टार्टेड। So for this, new technology was needed and link it with continuous biological evolution. So with biological evolution, now human brain start thinking, brain start exploring new things, and this exploration result into finding of a metal that is copper. So copper was first metal which was used by human being. Parallelly, he also explored bronze. So later copper bronze mixing happens and with different proportions different kinds of artifacts were formed. And from our Neolithic time period or even earlier, from upper Paleolithic, it was Homo sapiens which was evolving. So with Paleolithic, Mesolithic or Neolithic, this is further evolution of Homo sapiens, because with practice, with explorations, they are adapting with changing environment, with changing needs. So now with that larger brain capacity, with more adaptability power, human being explored new metal and new types of tools. So now they learn to make alloys. Bronze was first alloy, and which was made by mixing copper and small quantity of tin, and sometimes zinc was also used. It is not like that human being has done some experiments in lab, but it was some hit and trial methods, and gradually human realized that this is best alloy for this specific purpose. So later these names were given to these metals. So but this was a gradual development. So bronze tools were harder in texture, but remember, metallurgy needs expertise. One should know the nature of ore, type of fuel and degree of temperature for becoming a successful smith. So these were gradual changes. Animals including sheep, buffalo, goats, cattle, pigs, these served as food to these people. So it shows that Mesolithic or Neolithic characteristic of domestication of animal continues. Now the rice cropping pattern and cotton farming developed in this period, because from Neolithic time period we know that from Neolithic agriculture as well as village settlements have been developed, but these stages of development were not uniform in all places. So with time, when where these metals were discovered, people got expertise in those areas. Rice cropping pattern and cotton farming were developed. Some of the main crops were barley, wheat, bajra, jowar, etc. Perhaps the skill was kept secret on one hand and the other metal tools must have been dear. So the common people still largely made and used stone tools. So main point is that if we compare Chalcolithic and later age, that is Iron Age, both are metal age, but in Chalcolithic, copper or bronze, these are very dear metals. They are very expensive. And later, that is iron, which is cheaper. So first is that metal was later times was cheaper. So iron allowed more inclusive development, and copper gave more scope to inequality in society. And second thing is, from copper time period, people learned about metallurgy and different practices, and they used that expertise in later time period of Iron Age. And that's why from Iron Age time period, more development in economy in social dimension noticed. For example, second urbanization in Ganga River Valley that observed in Iron Age. So you can connect, and when you compare and connect Chalcolithic with Neolithic with Iron Age, then you can understand how gradual changes were happening and how one culture was more advanced in technology and economy as compared to preceding culture. Now, this stage in which both stone and copper and other metals were used for making tools, this is known as Chalcolithic culture. Harappan culture was part of this period. As our syllabus has mentioned, Harappan, pre-Harappan sites differently, we will discuss in detail later. But if something asked about Chalcolithic, so you can mention Harappan culture as a subheading. So that will give more dimensions to your answer. As India is a land of diverse geographical features, over this vast land culture also varied. So no unilinear pattern of cultural development is observed. As you know, at the time in hills and jungles, people continue as hunter and gatherers. You can link this point even in present times, because present Indian society also have hunters and gatherers. For example, Jorwas, Sentinelese. So you can use these examples and link with contemporary times as well. While in neighboring river valleys, Neolithic culture is flourished. So all this development were occurring simultaneously. So similarly, you shall see that within major cultural phases like Chalcolithic, regional variations also existed. So some of famous archaeologists like H.T. Sankalia, he has mentioned, there appeared an effort to reconstruct the past ways of life in different regions. Detailed exploration of Chalcolithic sites were followed, particularly in central and western India. That's why we have discussed more Chalcolithic sites in this area. And you can draw maps with excavations at a few chosen sites. So now we will discuss some different types of Chalcolithic sites. So for every site, what you have to do is, for example, Ahar culture or Ahar or Banas culture. So here you have to draw map to show that in which region this was followed. Secondly, its time period, some special features of this culture, and later on add some other features observed. And you can write here some common points which all Chalcolithic cultures observed. So this will give you some extra points, because for every culture, for example, Ahar, Banas, there may not be enough material to write 10 marks. Or you may not remember some typical uniform points, special points for every culture. So try to remember some important 3 to 4 points, and later on, if time permits, if space permits, you can add some common points of Chalcolithic phase so that your answer look more holistic. Now, Ahar culture. So this is also known as Banas culture, among the earliest Chalcolithic cultures of India after Harappan. This is seen from calibrated radiocarbon dating. The culture has been named after famous site Ahar in district Udaipur, and this was excavated by H.D. Sankalia. So famous sites in this Ahar culture are Gilund, Bagor, Oziana, and excavations reveal the evidence of single, double, multi-roomed, rectangular and circular houses made of stone, mud bricks, mud. One important point is that you have to make your brain trained here that in archaeology you have to remember so much facts. It seems very silly to mention these points regarding which kind of houses are found and all, but you have to remember these points. Houses varied in size from site to site. So important points are that H.D. Sankalia, you can mention him, and secondly, draw area of Rajasthan, Gilund, Bagor and Oziana. Now at Balathal, this is another important site, and Gilund, a number of deep silos of various sizes tied with grass and plastered with lime have been found. So it means there were some kind of silos or some storage structure have been made in ground, and they are also covered with plastered or grass. It was predominated by copper objects, which included flat axes, chopper knives, razors, chisel, arrowheads. It is marked by a rich, complete absence of stone tools at Ahar. So from this paragraph, you can remember one important point that Ahar site have absence of stone tools. Because in later other sites, you will notice that almost all sites have combination of tools, but at Ahar there is absence of stone tools. But at other sites like Gilund, stone tools including microblades, microliths have been found. These are characteristics of Mesolithic sites. Now, beads of semi-precious statite and terracotta, rings of copper, petaled ornaments of copper and bone have been recovered. So remember that these kinds of terracotta figurines or beads you have studied in GS, that Harappan cultures have these features. So you can connect that if both these sites are belonging to same period, then of course some similarities will be observed. So you can connect these points. Economy was based on combination of cultivation, animal husbandry and hunting. So as Rajasthan area has fertile land, particularly at that time, because rivers like Ghaggars have provided ground for flourishing of civilizations like Harappa. So that ground has provided scope for cultivation as well. Around 35 sites have been excavated and they are dated by carbon 14, and approximate age is 3600 BC to 1500 BC. Remember some common idea regarding chronology, which makes it the oldest contemporary Chalcolithic culture outside the Harappan area. It was earlier thought that metal technology spread to peninsular India through Harappan, because Harappan sites were observed earlier and they are older. But later evidence suggested that from Balathal, excavations at Balathal shows that these developments had earlier taken place by early 3rd century BC. It therefore appears to be local development. So this is evaluation part, and you can mention it separately as heading as origin and dispersal of Ahar culture. So where you can mention clearly that there are different arguments regarding origin, but excavations at Balathal has given contradictory results, that this is probably a indigenous development. Now Kyatha culture, it is named after two sites, Kyatha on Choti Kalasindh. It was discovered by Vakankar, and in the northern part of Malwa more than 40 sites have been located. Again, you have to draw a map and show where is Kyatha culture. Important excavated sites are Kyatha and Dangwada. In Ahar culture, important sites were Gilund, Oziana. So remember those sites. The Kyatha site revealed a threefold culture sequence as period 1, 2 and 3. The principal wear is sturdy, wear thrown on a fast wheel from extremely fine pinkish well-navigated clay. So it shows that they have more refined, more polished kind of pottery making. Typical ceramic of Kyatha culture is chocolate slipped, sturdy and well-baked Kyatha ware. The shape in this ware were convex-sided and carninated dishes. So it shows that their jars have convex sides. So this shows their shape. They domesticated cattle, sheep, goat, hence their economy is based on agriculture and animal husbandry. The Kyatha people used both copper and stone tools. So now you can connect point that a site have absence of stone tools. Copper tools are represented by elongated axes. Those stone tools comprise microliths and blades. C4 datin has shown its age approximately 2550 to 1700 BC. Again, another work you what you can do, if particular site asked, then you can draw some tools as well, like axes or some microliths, blades, so that you can show that Chalcolithic has combination of different tools. Now, Malwa culture. So, more than 100 sites have been discovered in the valleys of Narmada and Chambal in Malwa region. This is Narmada and Chambal in Malwa region. Important sites are Nagda, Navdatoli and Iran. Remember important sites, and when you draw map, then show these sites particularly. Noteworthy are channels, pouted bowls. So these shaped bowls are also found, and pedestal goblets. So you can remember that these type of glasses, these type of glasses type features, and these type of artifacts also found from Navdatoli, which have parallels at Iranian site. So now another point or another heading which you can mention is origin. Another point you can mention is debate on origin, and you can show that some features like goblets from Navdatoli have shown that they have some contact with Iranian site. So there may be some exogenous influence on indigenous cultures. So there may be some mixing, and there is still debate whether Malwa culture have indigenous origin or have outside influence as well. So at Navdatoli, a square pit have been identified as a sacrificial pit. People lived in wattle and daub houses, so it's like very hut like houses with low mud wall, thatched roof as indicated by post, and clay plaster with bamboo and reed impressions. So huts were either round or rectangular. Economy, again agriculture and herder. Ornaments such as beads of semi-precious stones, copper rings, these are found. Terracotta figurines including male bull and female figurines. So if all these things are find out, you can show that they have specialization in making terracotta figurines, and equal focus on male as well as female counterpart has been given. See, 14 date shows that these are around 2000 to 1600 BC. So now you can compare that Malwa culture is younger as compared to Ahar culture as well as Kyatha culture. Now Jorve culture. So it succeeds Malwa culture. So again, Jorve culture is most youngest at Katwad, most youngest is youngest at Inamgoan, Prakash, Daimabad. These are important sites in northern Deccan. It is widely distributed in Maharashtra, where more than 200 sites have been excavated on the basis of ceramic structure and material remains. See, 14 dates of different sites. Jorve culture has been divided into two. Firstly, early Jorve, 1500 to 1100 BC, and second is late Jorve, that is 1100 to 800 BC. Jorve settlements have been classified into villages, hamlets, farmsteads and camps. So in early Jorve culture, we have found that their houses were rectangular structure with low mud walls made of wattle and daub. So again, hut-like features. Floors were well ramped with mud, with mixed tan gravel. Houses has oval fire hearth and large pit site. So they also have some pit to storage material. Late Jorve houses were more refined, and they have small round huts with low mud wall in cluster of 3 or 4 legged storage doors. So important feature is that in early Jorve culture, we have seen that some kind of pit, some kind of hole in ground is observed. But in later Jorve culture, there are some above ground features like storage jars were formed. So now it shows that later Jorve people have more idea regarding how some storage features can be formed. These are spotted on flat stones replacing the early Jorve pit silos. So characteristic Jorve ware was wheel made. You can notice this well fired, painted black on red with simple geometric motifs and matted surface. As this is youngest, so now you can observe, of course, some geometric features also observed. Copper objects including axes, chisel, dagger with midriff, stone blades, microliths, these are also found. Beads of gold and ivory, spiral earrings, anklets of copper. This shows that they have interest in fashion as well. So these are recovered from Inamgon. If some common points you have to write Chalcolithic, so you can write that different kind of variation with different specialization have been observed. Now next is ochre colored pottery. So this was first recognized by B.P. Lal in 1951 at Bisoli and Rajpur Parsu in Uttar Pradesh. These two sites are in Uttar Pradesh and third site is Hastinapura. This is also observed by Lal. So at a majority of sites, OCP is found in small bits, but some larger sites are also observed like Bhatpura, Ambikheri, Bargaon. OCP people had a sedentary existence similar to many early farming communities. So this shows that they are well settled people, and of course it is also related with some village type community. And if there is some village community, then you can relate that they will have some organized way of governance. So some kind of village council also exist, which have provided some medium of social control. The copper hoards consist of implements of different kinds such as cells, rings, harpoons, double axis, antenna also observed. A close examination of OCP from Upper Ganga Basin shows that it has similarities with pre-Harappan or early Harappan artifacts. So this point shows that maybe when some theories like Lal or Misra has mentioned that rivers like Ghagra, they have dried up and Indus Valley civilizations got extinct. So if this had happened, then those peoples have migrated towards Eastern Ganga side. And in that time period, they have also transferred their technology of metal casting, as well as they have colonized these part of Uttar Pradesh or North MP. And in those areas, OCP type pottery have been found. So this point shows this analysis. You can mention this point differently. The people of this culture were forced to move the Upper Ganga Basin and later to Middle Ganga Valley under the adverse circumstances. So these are again some evaluation points. Now painted grayware culture. So painted grayware is a very fine, smooth and even colored gray pottery, because this is again successor of OCP pottery. So this will be more refined, more advanced. It was made out of well worked, very high quality clay. The dates of PGW culture ranges from 1100 to 500 or 400 BC. And the date shows a wide geographical distribution from the Himalaya foothills to Malwa Plateau to Bahawalpur region of Pakistan to Kasambi near Allahabad. So you can again make a map and show these sites. It is slightly difficult to draw every site here, but you can draw them. PGW was first identified at Achichatra at Bareilly in 1914, but its significance only understood when excavations at Hastinapur done, and special archaeologists like Lal have contributed a lot. Structural remains at PGW levels consist mainly of wattle and daub mud huts. Again, that hut type houses, unbaked bricks, and one big brick were found at Hastinapura. Association of iron with PGW has drawn the attention of archaeologists for long. There have been a series of debates on the impact of iron technology at the beginning of urbanism in the Ganga Valley, known as second urbanization. So this again shows that with more advanced technology, now people have started more city life, more specialization in occupation, as well as more centralized authority in political sphere. It shows second urbanization because first urbanization was observed at IVC sites. And from Hastinapura and these sites, you can remember that now some Janpadas, Mahajanpadas, these were started developing. So with iron technology, you can relate that now bigger empires started develop, have with standing armies, some tax collection methods. So these were all result of iron technology, because with iron there was more inequality arises. Remember that iron as a metal give more equality in society because it is cheap, but as there is a plenty of metal now, more sharp and fine tools, so more cutting of forest, then more agriculture. So with agriculture, some people have more specialization and they now started to dominate others. With hunting, gathering or and other occupational methods, there is a little scope of inequality, but with agriculture there is a large scope of inequality. With inequality, with surplus, now people need someone, some centralized authority, some social control method, so that their surplus is protected from outsiders who have deficit. So this all led to some method of control or some political structures. Even thinkers like Bhattacharya, who is famous archaeologist, who have mentioned that growth of any advanced civilization, especially in economic terms, depends on how social cultural life is organized, because in different societies different methods are used. For some it is maybe kinship, for others it is maybe modern state, and for some others maybe some harsh methods like army. To maintain economic surplus, to maintain economic superiority, some social cultural institutions are used. So now I am connecting it with social anthropology. I hope you have understood my point, because with iron and especially PGW culture, now there is more economic surplus, now there is growth of different social economic institutions. At many times it is difficult to put the material assemblies in neatly defined categories. A lot of overlapping of cultural tradition is noticed, which speaks of considerable vibrancy and mobility in the cultural landscape. So it shows that there is so much diversity, and we have seen that there is a diversity from temporal as well as regional dimension. So for every culture or every time period like Chalcolithic, or further any site like Aharbanas, there are many variations. So for you, it is important that you remember some particular points and also have some common ideas, so that you can write remaining points as some come as different heading or as some other points observed which are common, so that you have enough content, because for every site it is difficult to remember 8 to 10 points. Better you focus on 4 to 5 main points. So that's all for today. In next class we will discuss about iron age. So if you have enjoyed these lectures, please like, share and subscribe Task IAS. And also I request you to revise these archaeological anthropology part again and again, because it is more factual, and try to connect it with social anthropology as well as with contemporary times, so that your answer will look more evaluative part. It will show more analysis. So that's all.